Are you a Mac person or a PC person? Are you both? Can you easily switch between one and the other? I guess today we could also ask, are you a phone person? Well, because there's three formats, right? Like to create art, you can use a PC, you can use a Mac, or you can use a phone. And then there's two kinds of phones. You can use an Apple phone or an Android phone. So these are the choices in computing for art creation. Of course, there's also Linux, but that's a whole other ball of wax. Today's show is about computing and about what platforms or software to use to create art. And what I use and what I've used over the course of my life to create art digitally, whether it's photographs or graphic art or laying out entire magazines for publication in print, which is not really done these days, but or even just hosting massive online communities. I've used computers for all that in my life and continue to do it. So this show is going to be about computing and I guess what I've learned and some thoughts about computing and art here on the Cannabis Goldsmith. This is a show about jewelry, why we wear it, why it matters, how it's made, and what it means. I'm Alex D, and I turn cannabis into gold. I make mind-blowing jewelry in gold, silver, and platinum from cannabis plants here in Canada for stage, screen, for people who want to rock crazy jewelry. I'm the Cannabis Goldsmith. The crow has started crowing in the background. So we've got some fans out there in the wilderness, out in the yard. Anyway, computing. Oh, man. I'm such an old dinosaur with computing. I go all the way back to the beginning of personal computing. So the very first one I bought, I think, was a Commodore VIC-20. No, that was in the 80s. And every new model or every new type of computer that came out after that, I bought one and or I built one. And from the parts that were available, the best parts at the time, and computed. And I built computers my whole life. These days, it's really common and easy to build computers. But back in the old days, it was really difficult because nothing was really tested to work together. So you had to kludge it to make it fit, kind of thing. You had to shave off the square edges to fit it in the round hole in your motherboard, kind of thing. But you know, back to today. I mean, people build gaming computers today. They order parts off Amazon or wherever, and then they just assemble it and then boot the thing up and then do whatever. Super powerful computers that, in their own right, could do any kind of like 3D rendering or graphic design or anything. But people are playing games with these computers. But it just, this is the state we're in today, where you can order parts, assemble your own computer, boot it up, load software up, and then you're in business, usually within a day, which is really quite amazing. I mean, back in the old days, it could take forever, weeks, just to get something to work right. And then to a place where you were happy with it, you would have to tweak it some more, and that could take another 6 months or whatever. But these days, it's all pretty well figured out. And we have the resource of YouTube, which is really quite amazing. So if you're building a computer yourself and you don't know what to do, or you're lost, or you get stuck somewhere, you can do searches on YouTube and find people who have likely experienced and solved the same problem. So building a computer isn't as scary today as it once was. But most people don't want to do that. Unless you're a gamer or some kind of geek like me, You're not going to be building your own computer. You're going to buy one probably at a Best Buy or some computer store or online, you know, and you plug it in and you turn it on and everything's there and it works for you. And most people are like this. And this is why Macs do so well, because Macs are that. They are, you buy it, it's all there for you. It boots up. Somebody else has put in the time to make sure that you have a computer that boots and does what it's supposed to do right away, like without any kind of interference from you, or you don't have to take the back off it even, which I found really strange in the beginning. I love taking the backs off computers and looking inside them. But you see, Macs aren't designed for this. They're designed to just be plugged in and turned on, and there you go. Now, as I say, there's, you know, two or three types of people. Well, let's call system builders versus non-system builders. So a system builder is a person who can build a computer system from parts, whether you're a gamer or a hobbyist, or whether this is something like me, you've always done your whole life, you can assemble a computer. You could go probably to a secondhand store and buy old computer parts and build something out of it, right? That would work. But why, right? Why? Why would anyone want to do that? Well, this is what separates the PC and the PC builders from the Mac purchasers. So, but then, as I said, there's a third group where who people who just buy PCs. I mean, you can buy a Mac or a PC built already and ready to go. And this is what most people do. But unfortunately, or fortunately, this is not something I've done. I've always built my own systems, and I'm doing it right now, actually. I'm building a new system for a digitization of an enormous collection of photography, my life's work as a young man, as a photographer, all the photos from Tribe magazine, all the rave scene in Canada and the underground house music scene. I captured all that for a magazine I published called Tribe back in the day, in the 1990s. And I shot all these, you know, over 10,000 slides and negatives. So I got to be digitizing all that. And I'm building a huge computer system but it's powerful in order to be able to deal with big files like this from the digitization, because these files will be quite large, so I'll have to move them around, I'll have to edit them with software to correct the color in them, I'm going to need a monitor that shows accurate color, this kind of stuff. This is all computing, right? But it relates to art very closely. So hopefully you'll get an understanding of what that's about by the end of this podcast. Now, somebody who buys a computer doesn't have to worry about all that, you know? They just say, okay, what do I need? What kind of a computer do I need to run Photoshop and edit big files? Like, you know, look at the finished, say, for example, if you're a photographer and you want to blow up a photo to put on a gallery wall, measure how big you want it to be. Just imagine in your own mind what it would be like to do a gallery exhibit, and how big would you like your photo to be. Then say if it's 2 feet by 3 feet, calculate how big that would be in a digital file that you would have to send to somebody to output on special paper, archival paper, to do your exhibit. So what you need to know is how big that file has got to be. So you contact the people who print those archival prints, and you ask them, email them. You say, okay, I want to print a file. I want to print a 2 foot by 3 foot wide photograph for a gallery exhibit. How big a file? What type of file is it? Ask them, and then we'll tell you all this information. So you'll have this information to go with. You'll say, okay, I have this image file, this photograph that I've digitized that's, you know, half a gigabyte in size. Say 500 megabytes is this photo. Now you're going to have to move this photo around. You know, how are you going to edit it? You're going to need a computer that can open a file like that, look at it, and then do stuff with it. Now back in the olden days, everything was so slow. The computers were so slow. The software was so slow. And often it didn't work well with the computers. Now, this is even true for Mac computers back in the day. Everyone was still trying to figure out what the hell was going on with the relationship between software and hardware and whether you could make art with it at all, right? So anyway, I'm back to the file. You want to make sure that the file can open and manipulate it, because back in the day you would have to wait. Like, you'd do one thing, you for example, you would blur a photo and you'd have to wait like 3 minutes for the computer to do this because it took so much compute power just to do that one simple thing. You'd have to wait, and you have to wait in between each step, you know, and then you would have an image with so many layers that it would just like crash machines. So this is kind of stuff you want to consider before you even spend a dime on buying a computer. You have to decide where you want to show your art. Where is it going to be? Like, if you're a digital artist, you need to worry about stuff like, what kind of software am I going to use to create my art? Like, am I going to do video art? Am I going to do still photography art? Am I going to do a combination of the two? Will it be audio involved in all this stuff? All these things you have to take into account before you get a system to help you as an artist. Now, the Apple side of it, most of these, they design a system to work for most artists, and this is what they sell, right? So everything pretty much is what you need there, unless you need some specialized stuff or graphics cards or some specialized kind of component in your Mac. This is when the problems happen, because the Apple system is a walled garden. So they like to keep control over everything in their machines, the way the software interacts with the hardware, all this stuff. It's like a walled garden. And if, for example, you need a special kind of graphics card that far exceeds what's already in the Mac box, you might have a hard time getting it to work with this Mac, because it wasn't designed for that, right? It wasn't designed for that additional card. Or maybe you need a capture card, something that can capture video. Or maybe a special card, a card to add into your Mac that can read old Mac drives. Like, wouldn't that be nice? Because you see, the platform, the Mac platform, is so locked down that when a particular type of hardware, Mac hardware or Mac software, becomes obsolete, that's it. That's the end of it. Like, it doesn't go on from there. But with a PC, a PC is like an open system where you can buy parts and build your own. So there likely will be somebody supporting an old version of something for your PC if you look hard enough for it. You might find it. But then again, we get into this thing with computing where it's like you can get so involved in the building of the PC or building of the computer that you lose sight of everything else. And this is the danger with this stuff. It's like you could spend way too much money on it. So either the Mac system is sort of ready to go out of the box, but it's also way more expensive than a PC of equal strength. So that's how it plays out. Now you have to consider all this stuff. So think about how big of files you're going to be moving around, whether you're going to be working with big video files, whether you're going to be working just with small things, or if you're a writer, you don't even need any of this power or computing power. If you're just creating text, you don't need anything fancy. You can get away with a $250 ThinkPad off eBay or whatever. That'll work for you. And you can spend your money on coffees at the coffee shop as you type your beautiful poems or whatever. So you don't have to spend a lot of money on a computer. Now, but the computer makers, because Mac makes their own system and they're responsible for everything in the box that they sell you, they are focused on getting you into that environment. So all their advertising is focused on that, on converting you to a Mac user and getting you into their environment. Now, the PC users are much more loosely, they're not even like commercially organized. Like, they couldn't all get together on one marketing plan to put together one ad for PCs, for example. They couldn't do that because it's so scattered and everyone's working on their own, or on their own bit of it that fits into the final PC that a user might build, right? Or a person might build. So what I'm doing now, this sounds also confusing, I know. If you're not comfortable with computers or you don't know anything about it or whatever, just get one that's already built, whether a PC or a Mac that's ready to go. But make sure that it can handle what you want it to do. That's what I'm saying. Look at the files that you're going to need to be making. Now, if you don't know, go to one of these printers. Go to an online printer who makes digital prints of a certain size, and you'll be able to use their online calculators to find out how big of a file you need. And if they don't have one, you can email them. They'll tell you. And then you'll know what you're going to have to move around and whether your computer will be strong enough to do that. And that's what you ought to look at. You ought to look at it from the final result and backwards these days. So that's what you do. Then you can build the system to suit, or you can buy a Mac that can handle that. So that's in a nutshell. You can hang up now. You can actually just tune out now, because that's the answer to the whole story. But there's more to it than that. There's a vibe to computers, right? Like, the Mac people are really quite different than the PC people. They are so different. Like, I know, even from the early days, like, I started graphic design on a Mac, but then switched to a PC after. And the reason I did that was because the Macs were beyond, the Apple products were beyond my budget, right? They were just too expensive for me. And I found that they weren't changing fast enough. As the technology got better and better, quicker and quicker, and the product cycles got shorter, so new chips were coming out, new graphics cards were coming out, like with faster frequency, the Apple people were stuck because they'd already built their product for the next 2 years. This is all they could make, right? They couldn't really, they might be able to update it a little bit, but as the rest of the world moved on, they were locked into whatever product model that they chose to sell that year or whatever. So I've got Apple G computers, these big aluminum fucking huge things. I still have them here. Hopefully they'll still boot at some time, in the future. But with PCs, I switched because it was just too expensive for me to buy Apple products, and I needed to do my design work and my publishing work. So I the software that I was using for publishing at the time, Quark Express, is now InDesign as a similar product. That wasn't invented back then, but that product would work. The Quark product would work on a PC or a Mac. And in fact, when you bought the software, it came with the two both versions on the same disk, so you could in the same package, so you could use either, right? Which was so nice. And it was the whole package. Like, you didn't have to pay a monthly fee for it. You bought it once. It was ridiculously expensive. And then they would update it and everything for free. for the full version. And I just, man, I long for the days when you can buy a whole software package and get it on a disc or something that you would have. Now it's all, you have to pay $50, $100 a month to just to rent the software from these companies. And if you heard the Adobe CEO, you should go look for Nilay Patel's show where he interviews on The Verge. He interviews the CEO of Adobe. And if you're wondering why you never hear much from the CEO of Adobe, you should listen to this podcast. It's just incredible. The guy seems like he doesn't have a single creative bone in his body. And they're all set up to just like seem to be set up to suck artists dry right now in the future, instead of the past when they used to support artists. Now it's all about subscriptions, and it's just like it's a changed product. Or using, they had to even dial back their plan to host and copy artist content and then run AI across it or whatever they were going to do. They had to dial all that back, right? Because artists got so pissed off at them. But this is what the software has become. The hardware is a little more forgiving. So the PC, you can build your own again. And with a Mac, you gotta buy it built, but you need to. So if you have a 500 a megabyte file you have to deal with, you have to find a Mac that can deal with that. And you're generally going to spend a lot of money for that, but it'll work, right? Yeah, hopefully. Now, this was always the dilemma, Mac or PC. And a lot of artists get lost in that whole thing. The software behaves on each quite similarly. So if you're using Photoshop on one, it'll look similar to the one on the other platform. Now, you know that, right? But if you don't, you know, there are similarities between the way the software performs on each platform. So you can generally, you forget what platform you're using if you're immersed in working on a design in Photoshop, for example, or in a vector program like Illustrator or CorelDRAW, which is a PC program. Anyway, I switched to PCs because it was cheaper. Also because I was doing a lot of internet stuff and I was building massive servers for our internet site, which was huge at the time. It was a giant online community. And so I had to build like stuff like database servers. And these are all PCs, right? I mean, the internet runs on PCs. The internet runs on PCs. So and next time the Mac people are telling you, oh, Mac this and Mac that, the internet runs on PCs and Linux, a type of operating system for the most part, versions of Linux, not Windows or not Mac software. So anyway, back to what should you get? Well, you should get whatever you can afford and whatever you're comfortable with. By now, if you're listening to this, you've probably already settled into a PC or Mac environment. If you're lucky, you can use both. So I guess it's like languages. It's like speaking two different languages, English and French or whatever. If you can do both, do it. Right? That'll make you a better artist and a better tech person, techno utilizer person. There's no better. It's just what you need to do the job that you need to do as an artist. Like, there's a software I use, CorelDRAW, right? It's a PC software. It's like Illustrator, if you don't know what it is. And a lot of the people who make signs and do things like that, commercial sign makers use CorelDRAW to do sign design or plotters or vinyl signs. A lot of them use CorelDRAW. I mean, I guess they could use Illustrator, but they don't. And if you go out into the countryside and you find these little shops that are doing glass cutting with like CorelDRAW, CorelDRAW turns up in all these places where the interface between the computing and the the material is very close. Stuff like cutting vinyl on plotters or glass or whatever, or you know, plotters, giant plotters usually. Stuff like sign etching and router control or whatever. You'll see a lot of that, and in from small shops, because CorelDRAW you can still buy as a whole package, and you buy it for your shop, and then you don't have to worry about it paying a lease fee on it, you know, if you don't use it all the time, if you don't use it every day, right? You can have it, and when you need it, it's there. So that's why a lot of these design houses still use CorelDRAW. For physical objects like signs and stuff like that, or cutting like shit on plotters. So I know all this sounds confusing. Well, let me explain what I'm doing right now so that you can, I guess, figure out how my thinking is around this. So I need to digitize all these photographs. I need to move around huge files, and my current computer system can't do it. It's basically a system set up for small files and some audio. It's basically an office desktop is what it is. And I need something much more beefy to do the editing of these photos and also videos, because I intend I'm going to try and make a documentary film from still photography. I need a computer that can perhaps do that, because video files at these really say, for example, a 4K video file at resolutions at the very super high codecs and resolutions needed for like a commercial film release, right? That kind of quality. These files are huge, so to deal with that, you need a beefy computer. So that's what I'm building right now. It booted yesterday, so I'm really quite happy about that. Now, to get a Mac for this would have been well past my budget. Also, I want to allocate my funds differently within the computer. Like, Mac has already done this for you. Apple has already done this for you. You pick the specs out and they build the machine and there it is. But what if you want to change your mind, right? What if you want to get a even faster, you know, component and add it in? Well, that's complicated with an Apple product. But with the PC, is you just okay? The new graphics card has just come out that is like 50 times faster. You can just rip out the old one and plug in the new one, and generally that will work fine if your power supply can support it. It's all kind of integrated, and you learn all that as you build PCs. But I understand you folks, a lot of you aren't going to do that. But in my case, it's like, okay, I need something that can move around robust files, that can do video editing. I need memory that can fast memory, right? I need all these requirements. I need really good audio. I need all this stuff. Then I need a way to get files around my network on a wired connection, all this stuff. So I built the requirements, wrote all the requirements down on a piece of paper, and then I went out and built this, bought the pieces, and I built the system. And it's, you know, a Mac of this nature isn't even available, right? But if it was, it would cost like twice as much, probably. So I'm putting in the labor, which is not much these days. All this stuff is modular. It all fits together nicely, usually. And if you don't know why it's not working together, you can find a YouTube video that will tell you why, and then you can resolve it. So anyway, this computer I built, it booted yesterday, and it got to the point where I can install an operating system. Now, here's the problem with PCs. It won't even install the operating system now because I need an internet connection on the PC. Windows 11 requires an active internet connection in order to load. So in order to use Windows 11, you need an internet connection. And if you don't have one, you can't use the software. It won't work for you. You can't even get it to load onto the computer. So this is where I am now. I don't have an internet connection in the room where I'm building the PC, so I'm fucked basically. They should have told me this before. I've got the PC, it's ready, it's able, it's built. But Windows now is being a bitch. Windows is being a bitch here. This is stupid. So I've just ordered 100 feet of network cable, and I'm going to run it across my whole house to get to the connection point and try and, you know, get the frickin' thing to boot to load the Windows operating system. Now, if you don't have time to do any of this, this is where the Apple guy's head pops up. This is where Tim Cook goes, get your grandmother a Mac. You know, and you know what? He's right. You know, when you're frustrated in a PC build, when you're building a PC and something hangs you up, you get frustrated with it. You know, you really want Tim Cook to come and resolve this problem for you, but he's not going to do it. And when you resolve it, at least you'll have learnt why. That's the way I look at it. Anyway, eventually I'll get an operating system on this computer, then we'll be in business. So it's all this stuff, I guess, that most people don't want to deal with that makes PCs fun and interesting. They're the computers of the people, you know, Lex Friedman says. Android phones are the phone of the people. And I guess PCs are the computer of the people. I mean, they're available, they're everywhere. You can go into the jungle in the Congo and you'll find a Windows PC in the middle of the bush today, right? You'll find PCs everywhere in the world running everything, right? In the background. So if you buy one, you're not going to be out on a limb or anything as the only person who bought one. That's for Mac and PCs. They'll both work for you. It depends what you want. If you want an out-of-the-box experience where you plug it in, bing, and it works for you, great. If you want more interaction with the build of your computer and you're an artist, do that like I do. I mean, God, I enjoy it. As much as this might sound like frustration to you about the operating system not loading on because I need a live internet connection to do it, it's not frustration. It's learning. That's the way I look at it. If you're going to buy a computer and you're an artist, before you do, look at the end result. And not just the end result you can think of right now. Go bigger. I mean, if you really, you need a little headroom when you build or buy a computer. You need to future-proof it a little bit. And I know that's hard to do with technology, but get a little bit better, as much as you can afford. Where your money should go, unfortunately, is into the graphics card, which is ridiculously expensive these days. And then the CPU, the memory, and fast drives. Very fast drives. Now, those are the components that add speed to your design process. So if you can get any of those down, or all of them, in your PC design, whether you buy it or build it, you'll be fine as an artist. Anyway, this was me rambling about PCs today. My cable is coming, and I'm gonna hook it up to my newly built PC, and then into the network, and see if I can get Windows to load on it. And then I'll start putting software on it and test it. You got to test the computers too if you build them yourself. So, you know, I've almost convinced myself to buy a Mac during this whole. Buy an Apple product during this whole podcast. Jesus. Anyway, back into the build. That's it for me this week. I'm not in the new room yet, but I will be the new studio room. But I will be next week, I think, once the computer gets going. Also, I've been capturing leaves. I'm starting to finally get leaves now. Jesus, it's been so hard to get the leaves for ring designs out of the plants this year. But the plants are, I think, flowers are starting to show on the plants and the leaf shape is changing. So I'm taking leaves and capturing them for the jewelry designs I'll make this winter. There's a lot of different variety in the leaves, but not small ones, strangely, and not narrow ones. Maybe next year for that. Anyway, that's it for me this week. Back to the build and back to the leaf capturing. The Cannabis Goldsmith is produced by Tribe Communications, Inc. in the Thousand Islands area of Ontario, Canada. You can see what we do at tribe.ca. Send us an email, alexd@cannabisgoldsmith.com. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next week on the Cannabis Goldsmith.